atmosphere is changing. Nothing stays the same. Heaven is waiting for the mention of the name. The spirit is moving, burning like a flame, healing the broken by the one we proclaim.
Raise it up.
Hostages of shame, miracles unfolding at the mention of a name. All darkness is fleeing, mercy raining down, healing waters flowing as our lips make the sound.
Raise it up.
Praise the Lord, church. I said, praise the Lord, church. Glory. Thank you for having me with you this morning. I know y'all don't know me. My name's Meemaw, and I have a few announcements to make, even though I'm not from here, so I don't know all of them. So forgive me if I miss some. But March 3rd, we have praise and fellowship after church for all of the praise and worship and choir team. We are also having a wonderful puppet show here shortly that's going to start. And then we also have our Save Our Children fundraiser kickoff today. How many love our children? We are going to be doing quarter folders, so make sure you go to the bank and get rolls of quarters for the children, because they will bug you until you give them all their quarters. Those are going to be between here shortly and Easter Sunday. We are also having an art auction, but it's not just paintings this year. It's going to be services as well. So we have pictures that are going to be taken and all sorts of other things that you will be able to spend your money on. Daughters of Zion is going to be meeting on the 4th, and the art night is going to start on the 7th and 8th, as well as the Foolproof Men will be here at 7 or at 6:30 on the 7th. How many are ready to worship the Lord with my little worshipers that I brought with me today? We're going to ask y'all to stand and worship along as we sing about the name of Jesus.
Just a second while they change costumes. Amen. How many love our young worshipers and our youth? Amen. This is no exaggeration, so listen closely. One of these young men may one day be my pastor. Amen? So you better love them, because one day they might be loving you. Somebody say, I'm easy to love. We're not so easy sometimes, but I'm thankful for each and every one of them, for the effort that they put into that. And you know, you might say, well, if they were in the choir, they might not know all the parts. They might not be able to do this. But they can learn, even now, they can learn to apply themselves to being involved in the work of God and the ministry of the church. Amen. And that is a ministry. So one more time, why don't we give them another round of applause? We're going to go to take a moment now to take up our offering, receive our tithe and offering. So if you've had that with you today, we're going to take a moment to do that. But first, let's go to the Lord in prayer and just ask Him to bless the offering. Lord, we thank You, God, for Your presence that we feel here. We ask You, O Lord, this morning that You would touch hearts and change lives in this place. Bless us, Lord, as we come and give into Your kingdom. We thank You, Lord, for all the benefits that You daily load us with. We want to give back. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. God bless you as you give.
Yeah.
Amen. Let us lift up this mighty God. We worship and praise you, oh God.
I worship you. You are here. the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Of God, but most of all, aren't you thankful for the Word of God? That's how we know His love and His forgiveness, through His Word. Amen. I'm thankful for the Sunday school lesson this morning, the Word of God that we have, that we can lay hold on today in our own hands. Amen. How many believe that this is the Word of God to us? Amen. Amen. It truly is His Word to us, and His Word has been translated. Amen. Amen. It has been translated. And if I say it one way, I'm not going to try to get it wrong. Amen. I want it to be exactly how He says it. But We just sang a song that has some Spanish words. How many know Spanish this morning? Raise your hand. Speak Spanish. Espanol. Oh, Espanola. I can't. That's why I backed up, because I sang country. And it don't come out Spanish when I say it. It's in my head right, but it don't come out right. And I'm thankful for that. But you know, when we speak to each other, you might say the same sentence to somebody and it might sound different. That's why you got to stay in this word, amen? So that it becomes the literal translation to your heart. Not just mere words on a page, but it can be transcribed on your heart. Thy word have I hid in my heart. Amen. I took it from paper, but I put it in my heart. It's been translated to my heart. Amen. And I promise you that if you love God and you have the right approach to God, you serve him with all your heart, your mind, your soul, your strength, amen, it'll be translated correctly to your heart. But you got to have the right desire. Amen. Somebody say, I got to have my desire right. Amen. Amen. Somebody say, you got to have your desire right. Amen. It's important to have it right. Amen. Why don't you just turn around? You don't have to leave your seat. Turn around, shake somebody's hand, tell them you're glad they're here, and you can be seated in Jesus' name. Amen. The older I get, and I am getting older day by day, and I'm thankful for that. And I'm thankful for it, not for the product of every day, every moment of every day. I'm not thankful for every moment. But there's most days I am thankful for the day. Amen. Every minute of it, I don't know that I could say I'm thankful in for it, but I can be thankful in it. And so we have a life that we live for God that's worth living for God. Amen. Amen. It is worth living for God. And I'm thankful that I have the history that I have with living for God. My heritage is such. But that doesn't make me special. Amen. My heritage doesn't make me special. It gave me a little bit more of a sure foundation, possibly. So I am thankful for that. But if we could this morning, I'd like to talk to you about a legacy worth sharing. And it has become, since middle of last year, it has become a passion of mine and for our team here at Four Winds to begin to, because it's a great endeavor. It's a big endeavor to get our hearts and our minds and our spirits turned in the right direction. Right. It's not a gargantuan task, and it's not a hard task, and it's not laborious. And it is those things, but not to the sake of negativity, amen? Right. It's a positive thing when we begin to focus our heart and our mind and all of our strength into sharing what God has done for us. It's not a hard thing to do. Amen. Everybody say amen. Whether you believe it or not, you should say amen. It's not a hard thing to do. If you come up and you give me a $100 bill today, I guarantee you I can tell anybody anywhere that you gave me a $100 bill. It's my perception of what that $100 bill means that gives me the unction to share it. You understand what I'm saying? And when we receive the gift of, when we baptize, when we repent of our sins, we're baptized in Jesus' name, we're filled with the Holy Ghost, we got a $100 bill and we're ready to share it. But somewhere down the road, we begin to learn that not everybody appreciates the $100 bill, because some people want $1,000 and somebody wants this. And they don't know the value of it. And we begin to let the value of that diminish. But let me tell you something. We have this treasure in earthen vessels. We have a legacy that's worth sharing. We have a word that's worth sharing, and it's valuable. It's precious, amen? It's precious, and our God counts it as precious to us, because he knows that if we know our word, if we know his word, then we'll share it, because if we know the value of it. I'm going to start off with talking to us tonight, to this morning. I'm sure you can see overhead a legacy worth sharing. We have the opportunity to reach our world. But you and I have an opportunity this morning to share. And we talked about some things in our Sunday school class that I'm thankful for. And I'm thankful that we got to sit together as men this morning and we got to share some things. And some of you, I'm scared for who you go home with. Scared for you, for who you have to go home with, amen? I look at one of them over there just about to bounce out of his seat. Sister Carla, you just make the phone call to Sister Carrie. She'll come get you and you let him do what he does. But, you know. I mean, it's nothing horrible. It's not. But we all respond differently to the challenges of life. Amen. But sometimes we just need to talk about it. We need to laugh at each other in a healthy manner. Come on. We need to laugh at each other in a healthy manner. I'm not putting you down. I'm laughing with you, not at you. That's what we say, right? But there's things that God has given us, experiences in our life that are worth sharing. The stadium was lit, the air was full of electricity of the moment, and now the sound of the starting gun echoed the signal of the start of this 4x100 relay race. It was on its way. It wouldn't take long compared to the hours and hours and days and perhaps even years of preparation and practice. It would not take long. It would seem like a blur, and this race would simply be over. This race and this type of race was not about the effort of one. It was about the effort of four. It was not about individualism. It was about teamwork. As Davis Patton entered the short 20-meter exchange zone that he had practiced and practiced and practiced to enter, he was still running at full speed with all his might. Never was there the opportunity. The coaches would never encourage them that now was the time to slow up. No, you're supposed to keep the same momentum. You're supposed to keep the same effort involved. And y'all need to listen. There's some subliminal messages in here. Once we get to that exchange place, that place of exchange, we're not given permission to slow down because my part's over. You got to continue through just as if you were running the race at the same speed. But as he entered doing his part of the race, at full speed, Tyson Gay had to start from a standstill. So you have one that's coming through that zone at blinding speed and one that is starting off. And at some point in that 20-meter distance, there has to be an equalization of speed so that there can be a pass-off of the baton. And Tyson Gay that day, for no explainable reason, less than a millisecond, he was off, and when he closed his hand, there was no baton there because he had misjudged the speed. It took days, hours, months, weeks, years perhaps for them two to learn that exchange between one another. A team working together, they had to figure it out that if I run, I can't just run as fast as I want and take no regard for you. I got to know how you run. I got to trust how you run. I got to have confidence in your ability to run the race. It's not the effort of one, but it's the effort of many that in this short 20-meter distance, it made or broke the race that day. Businesses, governments, and many other entities across our world on an everyday occurrence, there's an exchange, a passing of the baton. Will the baton come to rest in the outstretched hand of those eager to take up the cause? Or will there be some split-second lapse of judgment that sends ripples into the future? Because just one moment of misjudgment, it sends a ripple into the future that will affect, I won't say that it's always detrimental, but it will affect the next generation. Right. What we do today matters. What you did yesterday matters. What you will do tomorrow matters. You're not always in that little 20-meter zone. Sometimes you're getting up to it, and sometimes you're leaving it. But there is a 20-meter zone where there will be the passing of the baton. The cry of Moses still echoes through time like that starting pistol that took off that day. It's the cry of Moses as he pled with the people of God in Deuteronomy 6 and 4 through 7. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart. and thou shalt teach them diligently. Diligently, with all your might to your children. You're going to teach them. It was more than just a plea. It was from the heart of an aged man who had run well a race. And he looked at a people that were about to receive a baton that day. And he looked at them and he said, you still got to love God with the same fervor that I love God. You got to still love God the way that I love him. It's not just about the way I loved him. It's that you got to love him in the same manner with the same fervency that I love him. Because there's going to be days when the whole crowd will look at you and they'll turn their back and they'll want to turn on you and they'll want to fight you and they'll want to kill you and they'll want to do this to you. And one day they'll be God's people and another day they'll be your people. But you got to understand that you got to be ready. And so I got to pass this along to you and I got to tell you that you got to love the God, the one Lord. You got to love him with all your heart, your soul, and your might.
Amen.
And it's not just good enough for you to do it. You got to teach your children diligently. Now, why would it be so important? Because they must understand the importance of God's word. They must understand the importance of the Hero Israel, the Lord our God is one. They must understand the importance of who it is that we serve. They must understand that. Just as you understand it, they must understand it. One version says this of this passage, that it has to be impressed upon them. Amen. As if there's a pressing in, a stamping upon, a tattooing in the skin, an impression made upon them, that it must be impressed upon them. And we understand that the frontlets that are supposed to be worn, and we understand when you're supposed to do it and how you're supposed to do it. And we'll talk a little bit more about that. But it says you should talk about it when you sit down in your home. Talk about it when you walk about the town. Talk about it when you go to bed. Tuck them into the memory of God's word. And when you get up in the morning, when you're waking your senses up, you should wake your senses up with the necessity of the word of God and the God that you serve. It should be the first thing you think about in the morning, the last thing you think about at night. It's not too early to tell your young children that there's a word of God that can speak to them in the morning and that can tuck them in safely at night. It's not too early. Amen. And when I think of these young worshipers, and I'm going to say this, and I want them to guard their ears, but I want to say something today. They're the most important thing that happens in this church. Amen. They're the most important thing that happens in this church because they're the future generation of what we're doing. And so we have to impress. We want them to do it better than we did it. You want to be so bold to tell your kids you want them to have a better life? Well, I want them to have a better walk with God than I've ever had. I want them to be guarded. I want them to have a hedge about them. Amen?
Amen.
It's not too early to love a young worshiper.
Amen.
Amen. And I'm going to tell you something. You look at other people and you might think, well, I don't, why they love people so much. Why? Let me tell you something. You don't know the background of some of these individuals that are older people. You don't know that they grew up in a home where they had no one to influence them to go to church. They didn't have anyone to influence them to read their Bible. It's only by the grace of God that they're here today. But guess what? I get the opportunity to encourage them. I get the opportunity to entice them to become a fluid reader of the Word of God. And many of you didn't have that opportunity to have somebody, and you ought to be doubly sure. Amen. That there's somebody in this church that encourages and entices them to be in the Word of God. Amen. Not forces them. Amen. Forcing won't work. You'll make them a rebellious person on a pew. But if you can entice them with the Word of God, say, Mom, why do you sing like that? Mom, why do you pray like that? Mom, why is you read the Word of God? Because it's my necessary food. It's what encourages me when I'm sad. It's what lifts me up. It's what gives me victory. It's what gives me hope. Amen. But you ought to put it in front of them. Amen. Entice them with the Word of God. This is a legacy that is worth sharing. Amen.
Amen.
There's something more than monetary value that can be ascribed to this. There is more to it than social or moral ethics that we draw from it. It should be the heartbeat of every child of God to know and understand and live and find their hope in the Word of God. And we go on and we find that it was later on that Joshua led the people into the land of promise, into Canaan land. Safe, somebody say safe, inside. The Bible tells us that, however, upon the death of the elders, that there was something that was lost in the exchange. In that 20-meter pace in life, there was something that was lost. Joshua 2 and verses 7 through 10 says, "And the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua, and all the days of the elders that outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great works of the Lord that he did for Israel. And Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died, being 110 years old. And they buried him in the border of his inheritance in Timnath-Heres, in the Mount of Ephraim, on the north side of the hill of Gash. And also all that generation that was gathered unto their fathers. And there arose another generation after them, which knew not the Lord, nor yet the works which he had done for Israel." I read that last portion there, and I thought about that. How could they not know? Amen? I mean, their parents brought them to church every Sunday. Listen to me. Their parents brought them to prayer meeting. Every Saturday prayer, they were there. Their parents brought them to fellowships. Their parents brought them here. They were at everything. The previous generation would have surely made reference to the Exodus of Egypt. The previous generation would have surely made reference to the trek through the wilderness, manna for food, clothes that lasted and lasted. Surely somewhere in their life they made reference to that time. Even if it was their great-granddad that they heard it from, Brother Perez, they made reference to that point. I bet you that somewhere on a wall there was a depiction, be it a writing or a painting or something on a wall, something in a tablet, something written down where they would make reference to what had happened to them in that time between they left Egypt and to where they sat that day. Surely there was a reference to this pillar of cloud by day and fire by night. Surely there must have been a reference here and there about an Egyptian army, that great and mighty army on the other side of the water that drowned in the Red Sea. Can't tell me they didn't know something about it, Sister Mary. They knew something about it. There had to be the occasional reference. Something was said. They heard it. They saw it. They knew that it happened. Wow, to have been there and heard all the stories. Amen. To sit around the campfire and to hear stories about walking out that fateful night, leaving all of their big stuff behind because they could only take certain stuff with them. The cries that they had heard through Egypt the nights before, the weeks and months leading up to this time of when pestilence and plague had hit the Egyptians. That's not something you forget too soon. But guess what? They were more than just stories. Please hear me today. You might remember youth camp. You might make reference to the times at youth camp when this happened or this friend or that friend got delivered from this or that or God done this or that. You might remember ladies' retreat or men's retreat. You might be able to recall camp meeting or conference where the preacher preached the house down. You might be able to talk all about that guy as he tore it up. But you got to do more than make reference to. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love your God not on a casual basis. Amen. Thou shalt love your God not on Sunday. Right. Not when the rest of the world goes to church. Not on midweek. But you got to love him with all your heart. Every day, constantly, in contact with him all the time. With all your soul and with all your might. If we're not careful, all our young people is enamored by the tales of a time gone by. If we're not careful, this can become more than a fairy tale. It's not, folks. But your world turns this Bible into love poems and this, that, and other. And it's in there. Trust me, it's in there. But it's more than just a love story. It's more than just a poem. It's more than just poetry. Amen? It's more than just a story. It's more than fairy tales about a young man who defeats a giant and we walk away from there feeling as if it was just that. No more than Jack and the Beanstalk. Come on. Because in all of that, there's a God. In all of that, there's a one God. In all of that, there's a magnificent Savior in all of that. And if we only talk about Jack and the Beanstalk, David and Goliath, who is their God? Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. I serve the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I can take you back generation by generation. I can tell you where it started at. He's a covenant-keeping God. They need to know that He's a covenant-keeping God because they're going to break, they're going to transgress. But let me tell you, my God, He shows mercy to generation upon generation, to thousands of generations. Amen. He's holy, He's righteous, He's just, He's dependable, and He's trustworthy. And if all they know is the stories and they don't hear, let me tell you something, don't drop your kids off at Sunday school. Don't drop your kids off at Sunday school. When they come home, you tell them how that story affected your life, how that story got impacted your life, how that caused you to live for God more and more and more. When they ask a question, and to them, it might almost seem like a fairy tale. But when you bring it into today's measure and you begin to tell them how that story changed your life. Amen. And I want to borrow an excerpt from a sermon that probably no less than once every year or two, I go back and listen to this sermon. And it's really magnificent in and of itself because it's only about one thing. Do you know who it's about? Do you know who the main character of the story is? Do you know who the main character of this story is? It's about Him. And if we can often become overcome with emotion when we think of the act that was perpetrated on Calvary's cross on our behalf. And that's why we can call Him our Savior, my Savior. He redeemed my soul. He set me free. He brought me out of the miry clay. Amen. He set my feet on a rock. Amen. It's what He did for me, but He did it for everybody else, didn't He? But let me tell you how it happened to me. You know, we can talk about how He brought the Israelites out, but it's in there somewhere. It's somebody's grandma that says, He brought me out. He set me free. And that's where it gets lost in translation because we talk about how He brought them. I don't care what He did for them. I want to know what He's done for you. I want to know what He's done for you. Your kids don't want to hear what happened in 1967. They want to know what's going to happen in 2027. What's going to happen in 2024? Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. And you should serve Him with all your heart, all your soul, all your might. Because He is a way maker. He is a miracle worker. He is a deliverer. I want to tell you something about Him, not how bland the manna tasted. Come on. I want to tell you something about Him, not just the water that came out of the rock and the bitterness that it had to it. I want to tell you something about Him. It wasn't important. The manna wasn't important. It sustained my life, but it didn't sustain my soul. I got to tell you about Him. And the water was good because it kept me living a little longer. But let me tell you something. The more important part is that I love Him more than I love the manna. I love Him more than I love the water that comes from the rock. Amen? So let me just tell you that the heavens declare the glory of God. The firmament showeth forth His handiwork. No means of measure can define His limitless love. No far-seeing telescope can bring into visibility the coastline of His shores of supply. No barriers can hinder Him from pouring out His blessing. He is enduringly strong, entirely sincere, eternally steadfast, immortally graceful, imperially powerful, impartially merciful. He's the Son of God, the sinner's Savior, the centerpiece of civilization. He stands alone all by Himself. himself. He does not need anybody else. Can I tell you about him? Amen. Hallelujah. He is unique, unparalleled, unprecedented, and supreme. And I repented of my sins. I was buried in his name. And I have risen to walk in newness of life because of him. The Spirit of the Most High is upon me. The Spirit of the Almighty is all inside of me. It's consuming me. Hallelujah. Amen. And it wouldn't hurt for us to get a little excited about what God's done for us. Because they need to see him doing something in our life today. They need to understand that he's working right now. I'm sick and tired of hearing what he's doing down the road at some other church. Let me tell you something. If you'll get on fire for God, you can tell your kids what he's doing in this church. You can tell your kids what he's doing in this young worshipers. You can tell your kids what he's doing in this youth group. You can tell him what he's doing for our hyphen, for our elders. You can tell him about what he's doing right here. But you can't be talking about what he did back then or what he's doing somewhere else. I want to know what he's doing in you. Because it is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Hallelujah. I think I took some medicine or something. I'm jerking all over this morning. Woo! I have a right and a responsibility to give him praise, amen, because he brought me out of darkness into this marvelous light so that I might show forth his praise. Amen. To the glory of God, let it be so. So we've got a right to welcome him in. And that's why I've been hitting this, and not with purpose, on multiple times over the past few services. That's why I don't have a right to come in here with my lip shampooing the carpet. Amen? Amen? But I do have a right to enter his gates with thanksgiving, to enter his courts with praise, because when I begin to lift him up, then what I'm going to leave out there can stay. What I'm going to leave out there can stay. Amen? We got too much of us binding together about the negativity of life. How about we bind together about the goodness of God, the greatness of God? Yes, amen. He is good. I'm going to preach about that tonight, so I hope y'all are ready. We have a right, a reason, a right, and a responsibility to give thanks to the Lord, to give praise to our God Most High. And I've come to declare the same God of the Old Testament is the same God of the New Testament. Amen. His power has not changed or diminished. Amen. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen. He is Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. He is and was and is to come. Amen. Amen. That's who he is. But if he's just the God of the first so-and-so church, amen, that ain't much powerful to us, is it? That don't affect me much. But his covenant has been written down in blood, his blood, the precious blood of the Lamb. And so I ask you today, have you been baptized in his name? Have you repented of your sins? Repentance is an ongoing situation that needs to happen even in my life today. I need to repent. Amen. I need to ask God to forgive me. I don't need to wait till I get to church to do it either. I can do it before I get to church. I can do it on the way to church. I can do it while I'm putting my socks on in the morning. Come on. We talked about that a little bit this morning, about being in contact with God. You need to be ready to ask his forgiveness when you commit it, not 10 days later when his spirit moves in a service. You need to be ready and raw in your heart that says, Lord, I offended you and I'm sorry. Remember how weak and frail that I am, oh God. You remember that I'm nothing but earth and clay. You made me like this, God. You remember that? Well, guess what? I got to tell you, I got a few more flaws that need to be worked out. And if you need to be baptized in his name for the remission of your sins. Not the titles Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, but in his name, because that's what the Word says. It's not what I say, it's what the Word says. Amen? Amen. And his Spirit is a necessity. We have to be filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost. I can't live for God on my own. Amen? And let me just tell you this. This just came to me, and we talked about a lot of things that can help us men to get the encouraging word of God in us. But nothing is more encouraging in you than when you speak in tongues and the Spirit makes intercession. Because you don't know how to fix this. 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 But you can get into the presence of God and you can pour yourself out. It's the best place for you to take it. But thank God he also gives us each other. Amen. His spirit is a necessity. And I want you to know this legacy that's worth sharing this morning. And so as we come to the end of this service, I'd like for us to stand together. Sister Carrie can come. But I want to give you the opportunity to come this morning. I don't want you to come with a need in mind. I want you to come with a worship and a praise on your lips that simply says, Lord, I do want to remember the pit from which I was. I want to know where you brought me from. I want to give you praise because I remember where I was at. And help me, Lord, to be able to share that. Lord, I pray this morning as your Holy Ghost power begins to move in this place, as your anointing begins to touch hearts and lives this morning, help us, God, to make a decision. Lord, I remember who I was before you found me. I remember what I was before you found me. God, I pray that you would help me today to share this with all my heart. That my spirit, God, would be changed in your presence. The negativity that I walked in can be changed. The hurt of my heart can be changed. I pray that you would help us this morning as we come to the altar, that we would lift him up and give him thanks and praise because he is good. He is good. God bless you as you come.
Lord, we praise you.
Lord, we praise you.